Programmet vi skal se i kveld er også en sølvprisvinner, nemlig Diplomatics, som vant i 1985.
It is a warm summer's day in 1984. We are in Maracas, British Caramba, where members of the diplomatic corps are on their way to a reception at the Imperial Palace. Here's the American ambassador arriving in his Cadillac sedan. Followed by the British ambassador in his Rolls Royce. And here comes the West German ambassador in the pride of German industry, the Mercedes-Benz. And what could be more natural than that the Swedish ambassador should drive up in a Volvo? Closely followed by the representative of a country which has no car industry at all, the Norwegian ambassador. The Kingdom of Norway is a small country, but despite this, we have more than 1,700 consulates and embassies scattered over 20,000 countries, including 27 in Norway alone. But it has not always been like this. Ever since the dawn of history, Norwegian ships have sailed the seven seas, making contact with people of many races. But the Norwegians cannot be said to have acted very diplomatically. And in 1066, the Viking Age ground to a halt. This also meant an end to the rich trade and exploration activities, and in no time, Norway lapsed into total isolation. Meanwhile, the rest of Europe underwent a remarkable development as a number of inventions and discoveries saw the light of day. The sea route to India, the art of printing, gunpowder, the automobile, electricity, the Negro, the Hawaiian shirt, the force of gravity, see-through underwear, and a hell of a lot of churches. In 1905, Norwegians woke up and discovered to their surprise that they had been ruled by Danes and Swedes for 500 years. The Danes and the Swedes had grown prosperous while Norwegians remained poor. As a nation, Norway was on the point of going under. Even before she had reached the surface, something had to be done. The keenest minds in the land put their heads together, or vice versa. It was finally decided to send the well-known polar explorer Nansen to London to break the ice and to prepare the ground for a proper Norwegian diplomatic service. Nansen was later awarded the Nobel Peace Prize for crossing Greenland on a pair of wooden skis. Trade and industry prospered, and once again, Norwegian ships sailed the seven seas. And in time, an airline was established in cooperation with Scandinavian colleagues. Contact with the outside world had been re-established, and the need for a professional diplomatic corps was now urgent. In 1945, an institute for the training of Norwegian diplomatic personnel was officially opened. The Academy of Ambassadors was now a reality. Students must undergo a demanding five-year course involving subjects such as eating, drinking, and smoking in order to qualify for the task of running a Norwegian embassy. Students are recruited from every part of Norway. In many ways, training resembles that given to officer cadets. Details such as how to knot or not to knot a tie, dandruff, cuffs and protruding ears, as well as deportment and adequate number of teeth, are of prime importance. And then it's off to the depot. Here, the candidates are issued with their personal effects. White tie, black tie, white gloves, top hat, spotted spats, spats without spots, tailcoat, suspenders, four shoes, two of each kind, phrase book, toothpicks, pocket money, cigar cutters, champagne swizzle sticks, and aspirins. We are now witnessing an ordinary classroom session at the Academy of Ambassadors.
Cheers, diplomats, students.
Cheers, 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 cheers.
Sit down. Olsen, come up here one moment.
Yes,
sir. Alexander.
One part cocoa liqueur, one part cognac, and one part green curacao.
Everyone is what? Huh?
One part green curacao?
Curacao.
Curacao.
Curacao is correct, but it's wrong. It's not curacao. And what then is it?
Champagne Brut?
Sit down, Olsen. It is not that either. How many times do I have to repeat myself? It is neither champagne nor curacao. And Alexander consists of the following. One part cocoa liqueur. One part cognac. A lot of cognac. And one part cream. And this is shaken well with ice. And I've corrected your papers from yesterday. And we certainly have some strange answers here. For example, Anderson, you're a bit mixed up. Do you know what you have written? Hmm? On the rocks with ice. Hmm. On the rocks with ice. There is no such thing. On the rocks is not the drink. The rock is the ice. So we say whiskey on the rocks, okay? And improve your handwriting.
The written questions are difficult, varied, and demanding, such as how many golf courses are there in Calcutta? Give your opinion on government structure in the Philippines without giving your opinion on government structure in the Philippines. Translate good afternoon, would you care for a cocktail, into 20 different languages.
Okay, fine. A bit more margin, please.
During the lunch break, when it finally arrives, students can either enjoy a breath of fresh air in the pleasant grounds of the academy or retreat to the cafeteria, which offers a wide variety of duty-free delicacies from every corner of the globe.
Up, 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 up. What's that? What have we got there?
That?
Yes, that.
Well, that's port, sir.
And you have put port in a
tup,
glass,
tup.
Eh?
Here we see one of the students caught red-handed committing the unforgivable sin of trying to slip through the checkpoint with port in a cognac glass. As a punishment, he'll have to go to the back of the queue. Diplomats must familiarize themselves with international dining room etiquette. And for this reason, students must learn the names and uses of the many accessories involved. We have now been shown some of the theoretical tasks the candidates for the diplomatic service have had to undergo. They're also given practical training. In this case, walking on a red carpet. It may look simple enough, but it's actually harder than one might imagine. The key words here are balance and concentration. getting in and out of cars where style, dignity, and elegance are essential. The instructor is always at hand with useful advice and hints. Today's technology has brought nations closer together, and as aircraft are the means of transport most frequently used by diplomats, they naturally need to study professional disembarking techniques. After some initial hesitancy, the students are quickly corrected by the instructor. Then, at last, after 5 years of hard work, the great day dawns. The period of training is at an end, and the time has now come to award diplomas and certificates of merit. Students will now be allocated to Norwegian embassies all over the world. It is important that students should feel that diplomatic posts are fairly distributed. For this reason, the process of appointment is conducted in accordance with an ancient and carefully prepared ritual. There is an air of intense expectation. Is followed by an end-of-term ball in the banqueting hall of the academy, to which wives, fiancés, and mistresses are invited, a festive occasion which traditionally lasts well into the early hours of the Nordic summer dawn, neath the light of the midnight sun, except on this particular night it happens to be raining. An ambassador's first official duty on arriving in the country to which he has been posted is to present his credentials to the local head of state. Occasionally, several nations submit their credentials at the same time.
On behalf of the government and democracy and oil production and peace, understanding for mutual friendship and people of the world, and I work together economic as is international well, as well as international and human rights for all development for and together to be and peace in our time.
Hey man, cut out the bullshit. Did you bring the aquavit?
Of course, Your Majesty. I have it right here. See?
It is customary for ambassadors, when handing over their credentials, to present the head of state with a small gift typical of the country they represent. Books, peas, railroad tracks, pickled noses, stuffed dictators, shrunken heads, Russian roulette, snowplows, ripped-off ghoulies, tattooed tits, whips, arsenic and old lace, contraceptives, hand grenades, foot grenades, vultures, and a small atomic bomb. And now the time has come for the newly appointed ambassador to inspect his new place of employment. After all, for the next 5 years, the embassy will also be his home. An ambassador's chief task in a foreign country, apart from that of acting as official representative, is to promote his own country's economic interests. We're now in Vienna, where diplomats representing a number of different nations have come together to have a good time. There will also be time and opportunity to promote one's national products. Here we have the Norwegian ambassador to Austria conversing with his Swiss and Scottish colleagues. The Norwegian is naturally trying to push dried fish, which is exported to more than 2 countries worldwide. And now the Swiss ambassador, watch his arm.
Swiss watches.
Cheers.
But boys, have I got something for you? Watch.
The superpowers, of course, are also represented. Here we can see the Soviet ambassador and his American colleague enjoying a friendly chat.
Well, you know, we've got something too.
It's most important that a diplomatic representative should be able to tackle any situation that might arise, not least where the customs and traditions of other cultures are concerned. Food and drink often help to create an informal and friendly atmosphere. This time, the Norwegian and the Swedish ambassadors are paying a courtesy call on an important Arab check. Shake. Rigorous diplomatic training is vital. Especially today when the traditional national dish is camel cakes. Drinking habits too vary from one country to another. Some permit unrestricted, even lavish use of alcohol, while other countries practice total prohibition.
Cheers.
Good one, this. It's a bit dry, but
very good.
How is it in your country, the economy?
The oil is quite good. I wonder about OPEC. Is that the brother of Gregory Peck?
Yes.
One of the highlights in an ambassador's career is when he acts as an intermediary in negotiations between the superpowers. Here, the Norwegian ambassador in Geneva has assumed the important role of interpreter in the signing of a trade agreement for the export of 250 plastic peace pigeons between the USA and the Soviet Union.
Your Excellencies,
Your Excellency,
honored colleagues,
Vereshnyas kollegim,
ladies and gentlemen of the press,
Vereshnyas kollegim, gentlemen di prezi,
it's a great pleasure for me today, on behalf of my government, to sign this treaty of commerce between our two great nations. Looking back on the long and difficult negotiations, could you please wait until I finish the sentence?
Yes.
Thank you.
Спасибо.
Шуби.
You're welcome.
As I said, looking back on the
long...
Didn't I ask you to wait? I've done nothing but waiting so far.
You're interrupting all the time.
Interrupting? I haven't said a word.
But you're talking all the time. You shouldn't interfere. You're just the interpreter.
Translatorium? I'm not the interpreter. You are.
You stupid idiot.
Обречнись идиотом ступидием.
Ступидием идиотским, да рубим дьяратски.
You calling me stupid idiot, you rat.
Are you calling me a rat, you stupid idiot?
Обречнись ратским ступидием.
Fortunately, diplomats do have time to enjoy the occasional relaxation from their official duties. The 39th Diplomatic Summer Games were staged this year in the garden of the Swiss Embassy in Oslo. One of the most popular events is the game of hat tricks. The gold medal was won by the Czech chargé d'affaires, who defeated the Chinese military attaché 6-4, 5-7, 6-3 in the final. The champagne clay pigeon shooting was won by the British ambassador from New Delhi. With a score of 395 points, he set a new diplomatic record. But the event that attracted the largest entry was the 60-yard cocktail race. The final was run in superb spring weather. The Swedish ambassador to Brazil just managed to breast the tape one length ahead of the Italian fisheries attaché from Bonn, as the photo finish shows. As usual, however, all the competitors were disqualified, as they all failed the dope test. Traces of blood were found in their alcohol stream. So far, we have considered some of the chief duties of Norwegian ambassadors all over the world. But what about a routine working day? When does an ambassador start his daily round? And when does it end? One thing is certain, the day commences early at the Norwegian embassy. Long before the sun peeps over the horizon, he has to wake up if he wants to make the 6:05 cocktail. Already by 11 a.m., he's on his feet, and after a quick lunch, he starts his working day by going through his mail. matter where in the world he may be, even an ambassador looks forward to payday. Paperwork is a necessary evil that occupies much of his time, but it has to be done.
Mrs. Anderson, do you know a dance starting with T, 5 letters?
Tango?
Tango. Ah, yes, of course.
Representing his country on official occasions takes up much of an ambassador's time, and at all times, etiquette is of great importance. Official functions of this kind are numerous and demanding, such as opening zoological gardens.
We are together again here to try to work something out.
An ambassador's working day does not end at 5 o'clock. Many would say that it hasn't even begun. In order to bear the burden of a long and exhausting working day, many a veteran member of the diplomatic corps will often adopt certain ways of relaxation during official ceremonies, like dozing off with their eyes open.
Anyway, I would now like to propose a toast to international peace and understanding. Cheers.
But even the most hardened ambassador will find it difficult to cope with a large plateful of bouillabaisse at the conclusion of a working day. But eventually, even a weary ambassador can call it a day, and this is duly marked by the lowering of the flag. This, then, is the daily routine, day in, day out, year out, no matter in what corner of the globe he may be serving his native land. But, inevitably, the time will come, the day will dawn, when even the staunchest and most dutiful ambassador will have to put down his glass for the last time and throw in the towel. It is no secret that international diplomacy draws up its own ranking list. This is most clearly seen when one of its leading members has passed on. Colleagues, friends, and associates from every corner of the world foregather for the traditional and very special burial service that is held for a truly tip-top diplomat.